try that again. Salam alaikum. Good morning, church. It's a blessing to be back in Abu Dhabi International SDA Church. Before we move further into the message, I feel at home. It's like a lost son who has gone away and has come back home. I have returned to the God of my childhood. I have returned to the God of my mother. I have returned to Abu Dhabi International SDA Church, and I praise God for that. It's pleasantly surprising, I met young Zachary just running across. He's grown so much, and we just want to praise God for Zachary. We want to praise God for his parents, and we want to praise God that Abu Dhabi International is growing. Amen. Amen. I would like to acknowledge, one thing about this church, this congregation. Is the music, the spiritual music. It's a singing church, and I want to imagine that as the angels of God look down upon us as we sing, as all these melodies go up, the angels of God are also singing with us. So we want to praise God for the gift of music that is blessed Abu Dhabi International with. Amen? Amen. We want to acknowledge Sister Larissa and the music department, Brother Tito, and everyone else, because God uses them to bring all this together. So we praise God for that. I would like to praise God for the song that has just been sung by the men's trio. It was like it was speaking to me. It was speaking to my soul, because it says, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and turn away from their sins, then I will heal their land. Brothers and sisters, I need healing. When I look at the state of our church, not only here, but worldwide, I am reminded of Nehemiah, who goes down on his knees, who goes down to fast, to agonize before our Lord and our Savior for the condition of God's people. We look at Nehemiah, who's not indifferent to the condition of God's people. And so we praise God for that song, because it speaks directly to me, dear friends. I would like to thank the church for according me this opportunity to come and share God's word with you. I'm not worthy, because I am a sinner. I am a chief of sinners. I was shapen in iniquity, and my mother conceived me in iniquity. But I pray that the Lord may cover me with his blood as we go through this message this morning. I had prepared a message that I thought was appropriate for this Sabbath, but the Lord had a plan. So I need to apologize. The Bible text that was read is not the one we're going to focus on. So I apologize to the church. I was struggling with my God, but the Lord had a different message, and we'll go into that, dear friends. I want to bring greetings from Musafa Company. So your child, she's still your child as Abu Dhabi International SDA Church. So our brethren Musafa sent their heartfelt and warm greetings to each and every one of us today. Shall we turn our Bibles to Ruth chapter 2? Ruth chapter 2, and I'll read in your hearing from verse 1. Ruth chapter 2, we'll read from verse 1 through to 6. Ruth 2 verse 1, and Naomi had a kinsman of her husband, a mighty man of wealth, of the family of Elimelech, and his name was Boaz. Verse 2, and Ruth the Moabitess said unto Naomi, let me now go to the field and glean ears of corn after him in whose sight I shall find grace. And she said unto her, go, my daughter. Verse 3, and she went and came and gleaned in the field after the reapers, and her heart was light on her part of the field belonging unto Boaz, who was the kindred of Elimelech. Verse 4, and behold, Boaz came from Bethlehem and said unto the reapers, the Lord be with you. And they answered him, the Lord bless thee. Verse 5, then said Boaz unto his servants that was sent over the reapers, whose damsel is this? Verse 6, and the servant that was set over the reapers answered and said, it is the Moabitish damsel that came back with Naomi out of the country of Moab. May the Lord add blessing and understanding to his word. Brothers and sisters, a story is told of a young man who hails from my country of birth, Zambia, that is in Southern Africa. This young man had been in the main city, in what we call the Copper Belt. So the Copper Belt is where most of the mining happens. So one of the key economic activities of the country of Zambia is copper mining. So this young man had moved from the village where he stayed with his grandmother and moved to the big city for in hope of a better life. So after a few months away from grandmother, in those days, mind you, there were no mobile phones, he decides to visit the grandmother. But the problem is, he still did not have a job, so he managed to find some amount of money, which was exactly the fare of the bus travel to go from where he was to the village. It was about an 8 hours drive by bus. So he by faith, set forth to go to see his grandmother, because he had missed and he wanted it to be a surprise. So he got on this bus and off they went. 4 hours into the journey, it was like halfway from where he was coming from to where he was going, the bus sort of stopped to give the people a comfort break. So people went out and they started to, you know, to get some refreshments. Some wanted to, you know, to use the loo for convenience, etc., etc. But this young man had no money. Okay, he had no extra money to buy food for himself. Yes, his stomach, I can imagine, was grumbling. You know, it was like it was filled with butterflies because he needed food, but there was no food. And I want to imagine, I want to put on my imaginative cap right now. If some of the people in this past were Filipinos, you know, I can imagine they are buying some very tasty adobo and eating that. Let me fly back to Africa. If some of these were from Zimbabwe, maybe they will be buying some very nice sadza with some garnish there. If some of these maybe were from England, they will be buying some fish and chips, etc., etc. But this young man, dear friends, had nothing. And he had to endure all this nice aroma of food going through. And no one gave a thought of him to say, let us share with this brother. After about 15-20 minutes, the journey continued. The bus started to head to the village, and now they were on the final straight home. After about 8 hours and 15 minutes, this young man arrived. It was almost dark now. So he went to his grandma's house, and when grandma saw him, she was so excited. You know, she went into this embrace with this young man. She says, "Oh, my grandson, I have missed you. I have missed you. Why didn't you tell me you were coming?" So this young man says, "No, Granny, I wanted to surprise you. If I had told you, it would not be a surprise." So they embraced, and after all the greetings, then they went in. Then this young man said, "Mom, Grandma, I'm hungry. Can you give me some food?" So Grandma said, "You know what? I was not expecting that you'd come, but I have some beans in the house, and I have some corn milk, so I'll try to make something for you." So immediately, Grandma put the bean seeds in the pot and they started to boil. 30 minutes after, the young man said, "Grandma, I need food." So the grandma said, "Young man, take it easy. It's just 30 minutes and this bean seed is very hard. It's not the simple one." An hour later, this young man stands up from the living room where he was. He goes into the kitchen and says, "Grandma, I'm dying. I need food. Give me food." So grandmother, not knowing what to do, says, my grandchild, there's nothing I can do. This bean seed has been boiling for an hour now, but it's as hard as ever." The young man goes back. An hour and a half later, he couldn't now hold it. He goes back in the kitchen. He takes his stool and goes and says, "Grandmother, maybe you're not very serious. You don't understand that I'm dying of hunger. Maybe I'll stay here so that I can watch how you prepare to see if you're serious enough with this." The grandmother, almost crying, says, "My dear son, this bean seed is as hard as ever." Dear friends, it seems to me that some of us are like this bean seed. Some of us have been boiled in Christianity, but there's no change in our lives. Some of us have been Christians for 30 years, members of the Seventh-day Adventist Church for 30 years, but we are still struggling with the same sins we were struggling with when we were first baptized, dear friends. Some of us may have been in the church for 5 years, strong members, maybe have held positions in the church, but we are as powerless as ever, dear friends. We are still struggling, dear friends. And that is why that song that the male trio sang speaks to my soul. Because when I look at the condition of God's people, when I look at the condition of the remnant church of God, we are as powerless as anything else, dear friends. Actually, sometimes we become a laughing stock. Jesus, if you remember in the early church, he left power through the Holy Spirit upon his children. This power moved them to love one another. It was this power that moved them to touch the sick, and the sick were healed. It was this power that enabled Peter, one just like you and me, to pray for Dorcas, a dead soul, and she was resurrected. And it is the same power that God wants to bless Abu Dhabi International SDA Church with. But because we're in this condition of this busy, dear friends, we are powerless. We are spiritually impotent, dear friends. How I pray, dear friends, that you and I will agonize like the male choir, like the male trio here, who agonize and pray to God, pleading with God that he will heal our land. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, who dwells in the Most High, Lord, I'm just a man of like passions, a sinner worthy to stand before your children, because you know my sins, you know my history. Lord, I ask that may you cover me with the blood of Jesus. I pray that may your Holy Spirit descend upon this place at this hour. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Our message today is entitled, The Hands of Jesus. The Hands of Jesus, dear friends. Shall we open our Bibles? Let us open our Bibles to the book of 1 Corinthians, 1 Corinthians 13, verse 2 and 3. 1 Corinthians, chapter 13. It's a very familiar passage to us. 1 Corinthians 13. And I'll read in your hearing from verse 2 through to 3. And though I have the gift of prophecy, and understand your mysteries, and all knowledge, and though I have all faith, so that I could remove mountains, and have not love, I am nothing. And though I bestow all my goods to feed the poor, and though I give my body to be burned, and have no love, it profiteth me nothing. Dear friends, this text is talking about Jesus. Rightly so, in the class I attended this morning, our teacher, by the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, beautifully delivered this lesson to say, you know, it's all about love. It's this love that Jesus bestowed upon us. This love then permeates to all those who are in contact with us. This love is so infectious that it will touch those with whom we come in contact with. And as this love touches them, it's so infectious that it spreads. And because of this love, this true love of Jesus, the church comes together. The church is united. Not only Abu Dhabi International, but the worldwide church is united. And the problem is, when we lack this love, dear friends, we lack the Spirit of God. We lack the power of God. Are we together, dear friends? So we are going to talk about the love of Jesus. It's all about Jesus. As we are studying our Bible, I noticed in your bulletin, you'll be having some studies, I think, about the plan of salvation, etc., etc. My challenge to the church, dear friends, is as we are studying this, is Christ and Christ alone lifted up? Is Christ and Him crucified and Him resurrected at the forefront of our Bible study? Or is it just a debate that we'd like to have? A debate to sharpen our knowledge? But is Christ being lifted up, dear friends? In our day-to-day life, at our workplace, is Christ and Him alone lifted up? The problem, my friends, is if Christ is not lifted up, then our lives will lack power.
Just a couple of days ago, I read in the newspapers one of my peers. We grew up together. And his mom and my mom were very good friends. We grew up together. And I just read in the newspaper that this young man died suddenly. So it sort of hit me. When I went back to do a bit of research, I understood that he was not sick. He was so healthy. And he was lying, it was in the morning, so he was lying in his bed. And he was eating something. And all of a sudden, he started to choke on that food, and that's how he died. A very healthy young man died suddenly. Then as I was contemplating on this, dear friends, my mind was taken to the Max Boeing 737 that was moving from Addis Ababa to Nairobi that crashed after 6 minutes of takeoff. I want to imagine that those people who were on that flight thought it would be business as usual. Those people who were on that flight were so sure that they would leave Addis Ababa and fly to Nairobi, do their business, and maybe return to wherever they were going. But it was not meant to be. As I was contemplating, my mind was racing again, dear friends. It took me to my previous job just before I rejoined you here in Abu Dhabi. It involved a lot of traveling. And I was just thinking to myself today to say, you know, any flight could be my last day. God forbid, but I don't know what happened to me in the next 5 minutes. And I was troubled, my friends. I was saying, if I was to die today, when the Master comes, will I be able to be part of that crowd and say, hallelujah, hallelujah, the King we had waited for has come? How is my state of readiness? Life is a gift. And sometimes we think we are in control of that gift. And hence, our readiness is not as it should be. If I had the understanding that any time my life could be taken away, dear friends, I would make sure I'm making things right with Brother Tito. If there's any wrong, any misunderstanding between me and Brother Tito, I would need to make sure I do that quickly. I'll make sure any shorty business I've been doing is put straight, dear friends. But it's because I do not believe that I can die anytime that I go on as business as usual, dear friends. These events of death really hit me so hard that I was saying, look, I'm really tired of this world. I'm looking forward to a city whose builder and maker is God. A city where there will be no more crying. A city where there will be no more pain. A city where there will be no more cancer. A city, dear friends, where there will be no more Alzheimer's. I lost my mother just in October last year. She died of Alzheimer's. So Alzheimer's is a very personal thing to me. But I'm looking forward to a time, dear friends, when all that will be over. But I'm kidding myself to look forward to that time when my state of readiness leaves a lot to be desired, dear friends. Jesus is coming soon. Jesus is coming soon, and am I ready to meet my Savior? The King is coming. It's all about Jesus, dear friends. She writes, the servant of the Lord writes, a revival of true godliness among us is the greatest and most urgent of all our needs. To seek this should be our first work. There must be earnest effort to obtain the blessing of the Lord. And hence the song by the male trio, you know, to say, heal our land, dear Lord. Heal my land as an individual. Heal the land of Abu Dhabi International SDA Church. God, not because God is not willing to bestow his blessing upon us, but because we are unprepared to receive it. Why are we unprepared, dear friends? We are unprepared because we cannot love one another. When someone has made a mistake, in what spirit do we correct one another? Is it a spirit of condemnation? Is it a spirit of rebuke? Or is it done in a spirit of love, dear friends? It is that love. Unless we have that love, dear friends, all this coming to church every Sabbath is just ticking the box, and it will not avail much to us, my friends. Salvation is by Christ alone, by grace alone, through faith alone, by the Bible alone, for God's glory alone. And today we're going to focus on Jesus. Can we read this last one together about salvation? Salvation is by Christ alone, by grace alone, through faith alone, by the Bible alone, for God's glory alone. Right now, dear friends, we are going to uplift Jesus. We are going to uplift Jesus. And I would like to do a very simple exercise with you, dear friends, of looking at the Bible, maybe in a slightly different way from how we normally look at it. Because this Bible is the living word of God, and it is only about Jesus and the love of Jesus and Jesus alone. Amen? Amen. So let's start to run through, to rescue the Bible. Maybe over the next 10 minutes, hopefully we'll get there. We'll go through the Bible as fast as we could, my friends. What is the first book in the Bible? Genesis. You're right, my friends. What does Genesis tell us, dear friends? Genesis introduces us to a man called Adam. Amen? But you know, dear friends, that there is another Adam who came later on after the first Adam, and that was Jesus Christ, who came and overcame where the first Adam fell. And because the first Adam fell, you and I have to die today. But this second Adam, whose name is Jesus, overcame where the first Adam fell. And it is because of him alone that you and I have this gift of salvation. Amen? Amen. What is the next book in the Bible after Genesis? Exodus. Amen. What does Exodus tell us, dear friends? Exodus introduces us to a man who's drawn out of the water. He's drawn out of the water and then taken into the wilderness for 40 years. After spending 40 years in the wilderness, this man then goes to liberate his people from Egypt. It is interesting, dear friends, because this second Adam, this same Jesus, is also drawn out of the waters in AD 27. And after he's drawn out of the waters of baptism, he then goes into the wilderness for 40 days. He spends 40 days in the wilderness, and after that 40 days, he goes to liberate his people. Are we together, dear friends? We are looking at the Bible through the lens of Jesus and Jesus alone. What is the next book after Exodus, dear friends?
Leviticus.
Leviticus tells us about the work of a high priest in cleansing the sins of his people. Interesting, dear friends, because this same second Adam, who was thrown out of the waters of baptism, taken to the wilderness for 40 days, then goes to liberate his people. This same Jesus, this same second Adam, right now, he's working for you and me in the sanctuary that is not made by hands, cleansing yours and my sins, dear friends. Amen?
Amen.
What is the next book after Leviticus?
Numbers.
Numbers. Interesting, dear friends, because Numbers talks to us about a man called Moses. Numbers talks about this Moses who caused the 12 tribes, or leads the 12 tribes, and caused the 70 elders. Interesting, dear friends, because this same Jesus, this same second Adam, who's drawn out of the waters of baptism, who then goes into the wilderness for 40 days, and then goes to liberate his people, this same Jesus caused the 12 and ordains the 70. Are we together, dear friends? What book comes after Numbers? Deuteronomy. Deuteronomy, dear friends, talks about Moses during his final days. Deuteronomy talks about how Moses caused the 12 tribes of Israel. He repeats the covenant that was made at Sinai. They sing a song, and afterwards he goes to die a lonely death. It is interesting, dear friends, because the second Adam, this same second Adam, who is drawn out of the waters of baptism, who goes into the wilderness for 40 days, who then goes to liberate his people, this same Jesus, towards the end of his earthly life, he calls the 12 disciples. They go in the upper room, he repeats the covenant, they sing a song, and he goes alone to die a death of Calvary for you and for me, dear friends. What book comes after Deuteronomy? Joshua is the book that comes after Deuteronomy. But dear friends, the book of Joshua talks about a man who brings down a city This same Jesus, the second Adam, brings down the kingdom of Satan with "it is finished" on the cross of Calvary. What book comes after the book of Joshua, dear friends? Judges. Judges talks about the 12 tribes of Israel, the children of God, right? The children of God continue to soldier on even though they do not have a physical leader. Interesting, dear friends, if you go back to the early church, the Master has been crucified, the Master is resurrected, the church, through the disciples, go on conquering and to conquer without a physical leader. It is all about Jesus, dear friend. It's only Him and Him lifted up. It's only Him and Him crucified, dear friends, that we can have that love for one another. And when that love for one another comes in Abu Dhabi, SDA Church, in the worldwide church, things will start to happen. The church will have power. The church will pray for the sick, and the sick will be healed. The church will be able to cast out demons. The church will be able to raise those from the dead as the Lord wills, dear friends. What book comes after Judges? Ruth. That was our memory text, dear friends. Ruth chapter 2, verse 1 to 6. Now, in the book of Ruth, we meet a Moabite woman. A Moabite woman, you know, who has got a Hebrew or a Jewish mother-in-law. What is this woman doing? This woman is in the field. This woman is in the field. She's bringing in the sheaves. She's bringing in the sheaves. Can we sing that song? Just one stanza. Sowing in the morning. Just one stanza and the chorus. Because there's an important message for us in this. Can we just sing just one stanza? Just one stanza. Sowing in the morning. Sowing in the morning. What's the number of that song? Sowing in the morning. Can those who are blessed with music, please start that for us. Those who are blessed with music. Just the first stanza and the chorus.
We are looking at
what others are doing, and we are bringing it to the church. Dear friends, Jesus and Jesus alone. Sometimes, dear friends, if you look at some of the trends of the church, and that's why we need to pray that God will heal our land, God will heal the remnant church. Sometimes, when we are moved with the Holy Spirit, a special song has been sung, we start to wave our hands. Where are we getting that from, dear friends? I think we're looking at what others are doing, and then we start to do. The church, the remnant church, is supposed to be influencing others, and not others influencing the remnant church, dear friends. It's time we start to bring in the sheep for Jesus. Do you want a king, Abu Dhabi International SDA Church, just as the Israel hold? They reject Samuel as their prophet. They reject God as their leader and say, give us a king. As a Seventh-day Adventist church, dear friends, God has blessed us with the Lord. He's blessed us with the health blessing. He's blessed us with the press reform. He's blessed us with 1 Corinthians 13 that talks about love. But no, we say, no. Yes, you bless us with all that, but we are not interested. We want our own diet. We want our own dress. We want our own way to love. We want a king. Something to think about, dear friends. What book comes after 1 Samuel? 2 Samuel talks about Israel, dear friends, in apostasy. Israel in apostasy, and then she's finally led into captivity because of her disobedience. Then after that, dear friends, we have 1 and 2 Kings, 1 and 2 Chronicles, which are all now talking about the time Israel is in captivity, which is now paralleling, dear friends, to the 1260 years when the church is underground. It's all about Jesus, dear friends. History repeats itself. What book comes after 2 Chronicles, dear friends? Ezra, we have three decrees. Ezra, we have three decrees. The first decree, dear friends, brings our attention to the sanctuary. Only God has to be worshipped. And that first decree, dear friends, parallels to the first angel's message, which calls us to worship God and God alone. That's why when someone sings, we praise God. We encourage them. We acknowledge them. But all praise should be directed to God, dear friends. The second decree is issued against God's enemies. God's people's enemies, dear friends. And just like the second angel's message, it is issued against Babylon. Against Babylon, the enemy of God, dear friends. Are we together, dear friends? Are we together? Amen?
Amen.
The third decree restores the temple. The third decree restores the temple and the city because the walls are then built. Amen? Are we together, dear friends? And God allows his children to say, yes, you can go back and be a peculiar people. If you remember, dear friends, it is under the third angel's message that the Seventh-day Adventist church is formed. And God says, go and be a peculiar people. But as Adventists, we're not interested in being peculiar. We want to be like the rest. We want to be like others. We want to eat like the rest. We want to dress like the rest. We want to behave like the rest because we want to fit in. And because of that, we lose our peculiarity as a people. And we lose that message that is supposed to be an influence to all those around us, dear friends. Do you want a king? What book comes after Ezra? Nehemiah, that was the song by the mainstream. You know, dear friends, Romans 8:28, and you know that all things work for the good. We didn't agree with the ministry or the song that we're supposed to sing, but it is so fitting to the message that is coming through. Because under Nehemiah, you find that God's people are discouraged. They are discouraged, dear friends, and they now start to focus on their own. They start to build their houses. They start to build their careers. But God's house is left desolate. God's house is left desolate. Yes, they earn a lot of money in Abu Dhabi. Send all that money home. While the church is suffering, the church can't pay rent, the church is in disarray, the mission of God is suffering, while people are enriching themselves, dear friends. Then Nehemiah, the servant of God is moved by the Holy Spirit. And he goes on his knees and starts to pray for the condition of God's people. Are we indifferent to the condition of the church today? When we see things, when we see one division hitting out at other divisions, how does that make us feel, dear friends? When we look at the indifference, the lukewarm temperature in the church, do we actually go to fast and pray for the condition of the church? When was the last time you went, fasted and prayed only for the condition of God's people, for the condition of God's remnant church? The answer to that shows us where our loyalty lies, dear friends. What is important to us? Because you see, the servant of God, Nehemiah, goes into fasting and pleads and agonizes with God. And God is faithful, dear friends. God is faithful. Nehemiah mobilizes the people and said, we should go. We have to go. We have to take this message to all the world now. We have to take this message to all the environs of where we reside, of where we work, of where we play, of where our families are, dear friends. We need to show the world Christ and Him crucified, because salvation is through Christ alone, by faith alone, dear friends. What book comes after Nehemiah?
Esther.
Esther introduces us to the death decree, dear friends. Esther, Mordecai, refuses to bow to the commandments of the government, and the death decree is issued. But he doesn't, and the Lord believes. What about you and me, dear friends? When my company says you have to work on Sabbath, what is our response? Something to think about, dear friends. What book comes after Esther, dear friends?
Job.
The book of Job comes after Esther. And we see in the book of Job a man who goes through a time of trouble. It's interesting, dear friends, because we are told that towards the end of time, there shall be a trouble as never been before in this world. And will you and I be prepared to go through that time of trouble, dear friends? After that, we have Psalms. We have Psalms, David, who's running away from his enemies and is praying to God, pleading with God. As we go through trials and tribulations, dear friends, we have our Master. We have our Master Jesus, who went through all that and is ready to deliver you and me, dear friends. What book comes after Psalms? We have Proverbs, and after Proverbs, we have Ecclesiastes. And these books teach us about wisdom. And it is true that the people of God, that Abu Dhabi International SDA should have the wisdom of God. Amen? What book, dear friends, comes after Ecclesiastes?
Songs of Solomon.
Songs of Solomon talks to us about the bride who is coming. And indeed, soon and very soon, the king will be coming to meet his bride. How I pray, dear friends, that we'll be part, you and I, will be part of that bridal party. Amen? After that, dear friends, we find the major prophets. Isaiah, Jeremiah, Lamentations, they start to talk about the second coming of Jesus. After that, dear friends, we go into the minor prophets. The minor prophets talks about the judgment and justice of God, dear friends. Then we go to Malachi, the very last book. It talks about how the wicked will be as stubble. How I pray that none of us, dear friends, will be found amongst those who are called wicked. Can you imagine? It would have been a sheer waste of time for all these years to walk with Jesus, but to be as stubble, dear friends. How I pray. That is the Old Testament, dear friends. All talking about Jesus. All talking about Jesus. Actually, you can summarize it as the great controversy. Then we take a leap of faith and go into the New Testament. When we look at the Gospels, dear friends, Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, they talk to us, dear friends, about Christ being truly with his people. About Christ being truly with Abu Dhabi International SDA Church, dear friends. Then after that, dear friends, we have Acts. Acts connects to the lesson we had, connects to unity. In Acts, we find one people. Yes, they are different people. They are from different backgrounds. But you know, they are as one. They are united as one in Christ. They are speaking one language in Jesus. They are united, dear friends. And they go with that power that is bestowed upon them. church here in Abu Dhabi. How we united as a church on a worldwide level, dear friends. Then, from Romans right through to Jude, dear friends, the Bible talks about sanctification. The steps that you need to take to live a victorious life every day. And dear friends, we come to conclude in the book of Revelation. Can we turn our Bibles, dear friends, to Revelation? Revelation chapter 21. Revelation chapter 21. I'll read in your hearing. And I saw a new heaven and a new earth. For the first heaven and the first earth were passed away, and there was no more sea. Verse 2, and I, John, saw the new city, the new Jerusalem, coming down from God out of heaven, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. Verse 3, and I heard a great voice out of heaven saying, behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and he will dwell with them, and they shall be his people, and God himself shall be with them and be their God. I'm preparing to start to conclude now. Keep your pulses on the text that we just read. I want to cover just a few things here. You know, dear friends, when we talk about Ruth working in the fields, bringing in the sheep, this is what the servant of the Lord writes. There will be no one saved in heaven with the starless crown. There will be no one saved in heaven with the starless crown. I mean, one who had the opportunity to gain a star, but did not gain that star. The servant of the Lord says, no one will be there with a starless crown. But what do those stars represent? Those stars represent your yield of working in the field, dear friend. I'd like to challenge each and every one of us. How many people have you personally led to the cross of Calvary? How many people have I personally led to the feet of Jesus, dear friends? She says, there will be no one saved in heaven with a starless crown. If you enter there, there will be some sowing the cross of glory that has found an entrance through your instrumentality. Signs of the Times, June 6, 1892, dear friends. She further writes in selected messages, thousands in the 11th hour will see and acknowledge the truth. These conversions to truth will be made with a rapidity that will surprise the church, and God's name alone will be glorified, dear friends. You know, when you're in the sanctuary, dear friends, you have on the north, you have the table of shortbread representing the word of God. On the south, you've got the seven branch candlesticks representing, witnessing, empowered by the Holy Spirit. And just before that curtain which separates the holy place from the most holy place, you have the altar of incense which represents prayer. But really, let's focus on the south. Let's focus on the seven branch candlesticks. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. This little light of mine,
I'm gonna let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. Let it shine.
Dear friends, Jesus is asking you, is this light shining? Are you letting this light shine for Jesus, dear friends? This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. Now that's alright, dear friends. Think about this little light. Is it shining in your life? She talks about a sleeping church, a listless and feeling manner of presenting the truth who never arouse men and women from their death like slumber. They must show by their manners, by their acts and words, and by their preaching and prayer that they believe that Christ is at the door. Men and women are in the last hours of probation, and yet they are careless and stupid, and ministers have no power to arouse them from their sleep, because preachers themselves are sleeping and preaching to a sleeping church. Are we sleeping, dear friends? Are we sleeping in Abu Dhabi, SDA Church? Worshippers array themselves in costly, fashionable attire. A high salary is paid to a talented minister to entertain and attract the people. His sermons must not touch the popular scenes, but be made smooth and pleasing to the fashionable ears. Thus, fashionable sinners are enrolled on the church records, and fashionable sins are concealed under a pretense of godliness. God can never bless a fashionable church that is hiding fashionable sins under the pretext of godliness, dear friends. Let's go back. I'm now concluding. Let's go back to Revelation.
the Revelation 21 that we just read, dear friends. If we go to verse 6, so Revelation 21, verse 6, let's read verse 6, dear friends. And he said unto me, it is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. I will give unto thee, unto him that is athirst. The very first line, it is done, dear friend. Soon and very soon, that same Jesus, that same second Adam, who's now interceding on your and my behalf in the most holy place, soon and very soon, he'll take off his priestly robe, and soon and very soon, he'll put on his kingly attire and his crown, and it will say, he who is unclean, let him remain unclean still. He who is clean, let him remain clean still. Dear friends, I'm looking forward to that time when it is done, because I know that my debt is done, my mortgages done.